really weak position, Mary.
Welcome to the Health and Well Project, Health and Wellbeing Board, special meeting on the STP. I think there may be some colleagues who will be joining us in due course, but I think we need to make some progress. So, I think we should go straight into item one, which is the standing item about declarations of interest. Does anybody have any interest? Chris?
Can I confirm on Council's partnership governor on the CWP?
Right. Okay. Anybody else? No? Okay, thank you. Item two, apologies for absence. You have a number, I think. There's a children's trust meeting going on opposite. So,
Brian,
so. Okay, anybody else? Mark, I mean, you're deputising for Karen.
Yes.
Who sadly is not well.
No, broken bone.
Okay. We send her our best wishes. Good to see you. Let's go straight into the NHS World CCG STP report. So, this is item three on your agenda. This is a kind of commentary, if you like, or context setting report that John Biebling has very kindly put together, which kind of puts the STP in context. So, I'm going to allow John just to introduce this report, and then we probably sort of seamlessly go in then to the main STP, which is item four. So probably does it make sense to take both of them together?
Yes, sir.
I think it does. So John will do a kind of scene setting presentation, and then we'll open up to a wider discussion. But just to say. This is a reconvened meeting because the last meeting we had, the report had literally just been published on the CCG website, so the I haven't seen it, so we thought it was appropriate to have a special meeting. In the meantime, we have had a debate at full council, and I'll kind of say some things when John spoke about where certainly I am as the council. But before I do that, I'll have John just to introduce the report. Over to you, Jim.
Thanks, Phil. That sounds okay.
That sounds good.
I'll sit back a little.
Yeah.
So thank you for the opportunity to present the STP, particularly in the context of a Wirral and the work that we've been doing on Wirral in respect of our Health and Wirral programme, which I've reported to our overview and scrutiny, People's Overview and Scrutiny Committee, and our Health and Wellbeing Boards in previous meetings. If I just go through my paper, some of the embargoes that were put upon it by NHS reducing friction. And actually, STP is a phrase that starts to create friction, which is a nice irony, well, not a nice irony, perhaps. In many ways, that the work that we've been doing in Healthy Rural on collaboration, on the co-production of some of the things that are up on the screen there to refer to, has been picked up in the industry. And some of our plan, which will be familiar to members, actually takes place within the STP. What you can't see, though, within the STP is explicit what we're doing on Wirral, and I think that's a failure of the document, and we will put that right in the future. Just going on to page 3 of the report, the STP has a footprint of Cheshire and Merseyside. I think that's a well-known footprint. And within Cheshire and Wirral, just to localise it a little, we understand what the challenges and the financial gaps are. And those challenges are being met by respective local authorities, working with their partners through their transformational programmes. So in East Cheshire, they have a programme called Connecting Care. In South Cheshire and Vale Oil, they have a programme called Caring Together. In Chester, they have a programme called West Cheshire Way. And in Wirral, we have one called Healthy Wirral. So it's really important that those four programmes that are looking about how we manage care in a different way, how we look at trying to reduce the variation, be that in clinical practice, be that in standardisation, be that in prescribing, how are we addressing that issue? And also looking about how can hospitals and systems work more effectively by integrating services. And it seems to me that we haven't made sufficient. So what I wanted to do on page 3 is ground this in the work that we're doing on Wirral. So there's a significant element within the STP about alcohol and hypertension, for example. And the things that are in the STP have been led by Wirral. So the work that we've done on alcohol and hypertension as part of our better health circle there on the left-hand side is reflected in. But somehow, because we talk about alcohol and hypertension across Cheshire and Merseyside, it's been lost, the good work has been lost because of the fact that we didn't engage in the way that we ought to have. The second one that we're doing on unwarranted variation on page 3 there, we're doing a lot of work around trying to reduce antimicrobial infections, and we have a Cheshire and Merseyside approach to that now. But somehow, because the STP has got a bad reputation around that piece of work, and yet again, on Wirral we're doing a lot of work on prevention, on intervention, and on reducing variation. And again, that comes into our better care circle. And then on back and middle office functions, we're exploring ways of integrating our services with providers and with commissioners as a way of trying to reduce. Now, page 5, I've just described a few of those to show the relationship between the two. What I don't want to do is pretend the STP is the best document ever. I don't think it is. There will be further versions, I am sure. The document does talk about consultation, does talk about engagement, and I think it's failed on those. But there's nothing in the Wirral component of the STP. At this point in time, there hasn't been developed through the Healthy Wirral. And there will come a time that we will need to consult on some of the ideas that people have got. And if I look at our better care circle, we've got trying to improve mental health, trying to improve urgent care, and trying to improve end-of-life care. So if I look at urgent care, for example, we are looking about what a more effective urgent care offer would be on the road. And we're doing that through a series of workshops. We've been doing that with patient groups. With Healthwatch, we're trying to get insight from patients about and the public, what do you think good urgent care looks like? So before we do any consultation, we would do some sort of, as it were, informal process to gather the evidence, to gain the insight, to then formulate the plan. Those plans have not been formulated yet, but they are a priority for us because we've seen the pressures on the urgent care system this Christmas, and that's been played out quite widely, but we do expect to need to have a conversation in terms of a consultation on urgent care later this year. So that would be an example of where we need to bring those proposals to fruition. So, but I don't want to see the work that we're doing on Wirral contaminated, as it were, by the STP. It's really important that we set the STP in the context that it is. In effect, the context of that is a response to the five-year forward view. I also think that the STP is misunderstood in terms of what it is and what it isn't. It's called a sustainability and transformational plan, but really it's a series of ideas. I don't think it is a plan as such. I think there's a lot more work to be done to flesh out what those scenarios might be behind the proposals. But it is a paper which begins a discussion, and if anything, whilst it's been a difficult discussion, at least it's got people around the table in a way that we've never had before, now engaged in wanting to have that conversation. The Cheshire and Merseyside STP, finally on page 6, I just make a reference to the fact that it's not a statutory model, it's not a new organisation, and in fact, if anything, the system of Cheshire and Merseyside, that the CCGs, local authorities and providers, are all part of the STP. So it's only a sum or a collection of its membership, and I don't think that was right, I don't think that's been articulated in the way that it ought to have, and we're working with local authorities to try and rectify that and put that right in terms of the engagement and in terms of a co-produced document for the future. So, hope that's helpful to colleagues in terms of grounding it where it is and where it isn't. Again, I'm sorry for the way it came out. I think there was engagement with some local authority employees, but not with members in the way that it ought to have been. That's a failure, and we're looking to address that. And we're looking to do that with all the health and wellbeing boards across Cheshire and Wirral, and indeed we're hoping to help to formulate that when we meet together in February. There is a statutory duty on CCGs to consult, and that framework has been well grounded for a number of years yet. And if there are any proposals that come out of our Healthy Wirral programme that requires consultation, then of course the CCG is completely committed to doing that. So hopefully that's helpful in terms of what we're doing on Wirral. And that's because the most important thing to me is what happens in our neighbourhoods, what happens in our communities, and what happens in the way that we as Health and Wellbeing Board jointly plan for those services, which I think is our Healthy Wirral plan. And I really don't want to be sidetracked by the unfortunate way the STP was handled, particularly when we spent so much time focusing on our Healthy Wirral plan. And it's really important that we collectively support Healthy Wirral as the way forward, and in doing so, influence any future iterations of the STP. The STP document is attached to Agenda 4. I'm not intending to go through that. I think I'm trying to contextualise that slightly. But welcome to the discussion, Phil.
Okay. Thanks for that, John. Can I just say a few words just from my sort of perspective, and then I'll carry on to the point. You must have been. I just wanted to say a few things from my point of view as council leader. I appreciate the comments you made, John, but it really does beg belief the total absence of any consultation whatsoever with elected members around this plan, and I struggle to understand how the NHS, which is a big organisation full of very experienced professionals, did not have at least the courtesy to at least share a draft with myself as leader and other groups on the council before it went public. I just think it basically means that we are having to react to a document that we've had absolutely no opportunity to input to whatsoever. And I think in that context, it really does, I think, set all sorts of hairs running which may or may not be valid, but obviously we've had the well sort of trailed, leaked email earlier in the year which talked about reconfiguring the acute hospitals in the patch. There is still something to this day on the Parapark Hospital's website that talks about moving to one PGH for the whole of the patch. And it's not surprising in that context that people, whether it's valid or not, believe that there's some kind of hidden agenda being pursued here. And I actually appreciate that you've given an honest account, John, of how we've ended up with this document. But I do believe that it's something, it makes it very difficult, I think, politically for me to endorse this plan, given that we've had no involvement at all in the production of the documents. And I, you know, and again, we had a debate at the council meeting in December. I've said publicly that I'm not prepared to endorse this plan until we've had some meaningful engagements. Now, what that engagement is needs to be discussed and fleshed out. But I do think, and I'm not alone in saying this, because I hear the same comments being made by councils up and down the country, many of whom have not also been, you know, consulted with when their SDPs were produced. I do think the credibility of this document has been, you know, I think, quite seriously damaged by the lack of involvement in the elected members. I appreciate that there may have been some discussions with local authority officers, but local authority officers does not equal elected members. And it's surprising that the NHS haven't realised that. So, from my point of view, in terms of what I've been prepared to do today, I think myself, I'm kind of happy to kind of note this report and your report, John. I think we need more information from NHS or government about what a full engagement plan looks like. I don't know whether there are any views about this, but I do think that we need urgently to have proper engagement, both with us as elected members and our local residents. And I absolutely get the point that you made that there are some some genuinely important things which Wirral needs to address. And you mentioned alcohol hypertension, unwarranted variation back in the local office collaboration. I absolutely get that. But I do worry that this has become such a toxic brand now, the SDP, that I think the government needs to think of a different way of coming at this, because I fear that unless they do, you know, it's going to be very difficult to make some progress on these plans. So that's just my my take, if you like, on learning on now. It's difficult because, in a sense, that the kind of damage has been done. So we're trying to we're trying to find a way of mitigating that. But I do sort of regret the way these documents are managed to do, and I appreciate all your comments, John. So that's just my overview. So, Jeff, do you want to say anything?
Yeah, just a couple of things. Can I ask Jordan a couple of questions, and then maybe make a couple of points? First of all, is there a proposal to downgrade A&E services out of the SDP? therefore we have to, and I happily listen to what experts say and what they put together within the report. So what I don't think would be particularly useful is if this becomes some sort of proxy for a fight between the Labour Party and the government, or whatever it is, in terms of this. And again, it just has to be sensible. Bill has enunciated this where Wirral is concerned that we need to look at all the organisations within Wirral to see where we can share costs, or we can share services, or we can utilise better a back office or middle office activity. And again, from what I can tell, a lot of that is in the heart of what's in this particular report, looking at how we can share those. So I can understand why. Following the council debate, that Phil has got himself in somewhat of a bind around this. But I do think that that the discussion had to start somewhere and had to be laid out somewhere. And I think what has been done within this report is interesting and clearly a starting point. But just as someone who is professionally, if you like, involved in change management, producing stuff in a black box and not allowing people in, but everyone knows there's something going on in the black box, and then sort of coming out of that and think this is it, in my opinion, is not the best way of developing a new approach. There needs to be buy-in, there needs to be discussion, there needs to be a shared understanding of what the issues actually are and how it is being, how you are seeking to address those issues, and why the report might say the sort of things it says, but what does it mean and what's behind all that. So I think I would say I welcome this as a start. I fully appreciate and thank all the partners that are involved for making the NHS such a success and for people's lives to be transformed in a lot of cases. So I thank you for that, and I understand that a lot of hard work has gone into this report. I think it's a good starting point for a discussion and for engagement. And I presume, and again I'll wait to be told, that when we talk about the engagement strategy, we're not saying, well, that's the plan, and there you go, you've got it, and that's what it's going to be. But the engagement strategy is going to be around, this is our start of the 10. What are your ideas around this start of the 10? How could we improve? How could we make sure that we keep improving the outcomes for our residents, primarily for us? We're all residents, of course, but for the people who put this together, the wider Cheshire and Merseyside footprint. So that's what I would say around this. Suggest to health colleagues that, and also to council colleagues, because let's be clear, it's not just the NHS. When you design and try and design your solution in a box, you end up not thinking through possible scenarios and not thinking through the unexpected or whatever. So it's always a good idea to bring in as many people as you possibly can, have those discussions so as everyone understands the root cause of what we're trying to do and what it is that's trying to be, that we try to achieve. And let us be absolutely clear, understanding Phil's comments about this report, it is not just the NHS that sits away in a dark corner to develop its policy and announcement. So I think if we're all going to work, if the NHS is going to work, then I think every organisation, including Wirral Borough Council, can learn from that too. Phil?
I want to go into some of the small print of the document because I want to be assured I'm not reading too much into the small print, because you know I love detail. But the first thing is that all of us have great faith and great love for the services involved. I happened to be at the division with wife this morning, so some of the observations is that you have caring staff that greet people well, that are interested in the patients, to call them by name, explain things properly, all those things that we love. What I was still seeing, poor David, is the issue of staff reeling trolleys around with great files that letter thick that they have to refer to and leaf through because we're some years behind with some of the things we're trying to tackle. Because the other end of it is my constituents' experience, back to the local level, being able to get, if they can, get through to the doctors to get appointments. So we end up in this circle where people are anxious. I want to get into the system and find that not all is accessed at the right time, which leads us to the issue of A&D and walk-in centres and all the other things that we're trying to bring together and get to cooperate. I want to, at the health of the people committee I went to, the resolution there talked about the particular consultative mechanisms. And things get to a certain level where there's a particular mechanism triggered, which is if there's a particular change in the service, then we start an official procedure, which I think we need to refresh the exact wording of that. I mean, comments on the document, can I ask if we, can I, referring to the large page numbers, not the small page numbers, so page 25 in large print, page 18 in small print, if I start with that one. Because on that page, Chair, there's a chart which goes from October 2016 to December 2016. Mm-hmm. I hope everyone's found it. And in that box, labelled hospital configuration, there's a talk about an appraisal across each hospital subsystem of options for hospital and service reconfiguration. In the next box, confirm future configuration of women's and children's services in Cheshire and Wirral. So when we read these boxes, we're particularly interested in what they mean. In the document, there's a lot about leadership and system leadership and a photograph of the person leading at the front, and need for managers with vast qualities of foresight and grip and so on. It's on page 60. But the document says at one point that over the water the alliance is about 3 years ahead of us. So if that is the frame of reference, oh, they're 3 years ahead of us, look what they're actually in the stage of arguing about or discussing what hospital does what where. To be told that we're a couple of years behind raises all sorts of hairs running. And I think what a citizen would be worried about is this an issue of rationing? Now, use that word carefully because you try to judge somebody on clinical need, we're trying to encourage people to be in the right place at the right time, but also throughout this document where the phrase sustainability is used, it's about living within the future known sums of money that can be used in particular ways, which is why I think across in Parliament there's a cross-party group of people trying to think of a new convention for the health service with an agreement about future funding. Because we go so far down a certain road to put things in action, because there's a certain financial imperative, which may or may not be relaxed in years to come. But can I ask if we could look at pages 52, 53 particularly. In the document on the right-hand side of the column labelled outcomes, for all the Cheshire and Wirral issues touched on, including this option exploring things between Chester and Wirral and so on, there is the outcome clinically, operationally and financially sustainable services. That one crops up quite a few times in each of those columns. And when we talk, when we go to pages 54 and 55, I think it was 16 occasions where there's a question, change delivered, explore the integration of services across Cheshire and Wirral with exact form and localities to be determined. So when you see that 16 times, I think it is, it inevitably sets the sort of hairs running that other colleagues have talked about. So I think the only way forward is to be clearly frank about where the system is up to. In the document, in several little small boxes, local government input, it says TBD, which is presumably to be determined, whoever sits on a particular committee to be determined. But this, of course, dates back to whenever it was published in October and November. And key figures might well be in mind to be slotted in as the people who are speaking up for local government or putting local government's views in. So if we do have staff who are in the position of about to be being introduced to that system, then we need a frank dialogue with them as well. Have I raised too many hairs? Have I looked at the small print? And it's knowing exactly what's going on and where it's up to and where our involvement gets triggered is, I think, the key to us.
extent Wirral's been protected from that because it's a nice place to come to work, but we're starting to see registrars not choosing to take a career in general practice. But we're also seeing that in terms of recruitment of our nurses and our consultants. We're seeing clinical sustainability in terms of issues of the numbers of people coming into some of our services, where we need a certain threshold of patients to come through to keep our training and education numbers in a way that they should be. And some examples of that would be ophthalmology. So I'll use that as an example. I can't quote the numbers, David, but you might be able to help me. But certainly the numbers of ophthalmology procedures that we used to do are quite high, and they're much lower now. And so to try and sustain a rota and an education and training programme for ophthalmology is becoming more difficult. And the only way to sustain that would be to join with the Countess of Chester and say, how do we create not one hospital, but how do we create one clinical team that's doing those sort of numbers? So actually, the story is creating a centre of excellence for ophthalmology by bringing the service, not the trust, but the service together to create a critical mass so it's clinically sustainable going forward. And that would address the workforce issue, the clinical outcome issue, because we get better outcomes that way, and also address the financial one. So that's the reference to clinical operation and financial sustainability. Another graphical example and reference to the Clare Hospital site that we mentioned before is how those two hospitals make best use of a redundant site that we've not really had a sufficient answer for. And the reason we're exploring how the Clare site can be used more effectively is a good example that's orthopaedics, where by visiting consultants from Arrow Park and from the County of Chester now operate together on the Clare Hospital site. Because there's some capacity there that we can use. So we're looking at are there other opportunities to develop the site? So it doesn't become the millstone around the neck, as it were, of our system, but actually could be part of the answer. I think one of the comments you made, Phil, that I'll put some words in your mouth, I don't mean to, but it's kind of, it's not what's not said, it's what's not said in the document rather than what's said. And so if I take the orthopaedic story, which I think is a really good example of two hospitals starting to collaborate to make best use of resources, it doesn't mean there'll be bed closures in Arrow Park Hospital as a result of that. What it might mean is that Arrow Park Hospital has a greater ability to deliver safe services, because I think the occupancy rate at the moment is around about 97-98%, and we really ought to be operating at around about 85% to make sure we've got infection properly managed, safety properly managed. And we really don't want to see our A&Es as busy as they are now. So that's the reference to Clare. David, I don't know if you want to come in and make comments about that site and perhaps the comments in the annual report. It was just mentioned to you.
Sure.
Okay.
So a range of things that sort of build on what John's been talking about. I think it's worth remembering that as well as being the hospital, that actually the largest employer on Wirral as well, now with over 5,500 employees. So we're very mindful of the fact that we've got a very significant workforce to look after as well as patients. We are an upper quartile performing trust in terms of the efficiency metrics. So this shouldn't be looked through about inefficiency. Of course, any organisation anywhere can always look for opportunities to do things more efficiently. But against the various long-term initiatives, we're in the upper quartile nationally, so generally viewed in a positive way. We are seeing increased demand for our services and increased acuity. What we are seeing is a very dramatic increase in the number of people after non-electively, so this is not planned care, where the demand's going up and the acuity is going up very, very significantly, meaning that we're admitting a lot more people to hospital. If I just give you a little fact just to show you how significant that is, if I compare January this year with December, there's been a 45% increase in the patient almost 100% occupancy. Last week before last, we had 102 medically optimised patients. That's patients that no longer need to be in hospital and should be in some form of alternative care setting, but that was difficult to achieve. So if you can't get people out, you can't get people in. Therefore, it impacts on flow, it impacts on getting people in the right locations within the hospital to get access to side rooms for infection control purposes or end-of-life care, etc. So really significant that the whole of health and social care work together in a much more integrated way. What I would say, in the five years I've been here, there has never been better close working across all of health and social care on the Wirral. I think there really is a very good desire to work together in an integrated way. We are talking about being clinically and financially sustainable, and the financial pressures are really significant. I'm still looking at a major deficit this coming year, even if I saved the most we had ever saved. So even if I save £50 million, against what we spend this year, I'd still be looking at a deficit of close to £10 million. So really significant financial challenges. However, as John says, it's not just financially, it's clinically as well, because we know in some areas, some specialties, it's very difficult to recruit. So there are settings where, no matter where you are in the country, it's really, really difficult to recruit clinical staff. And that is doctors, but it's also physiotherapists, and it's nursing. So, for example, we mentioned about women's and children's being a cross-cutting theme. Properly trained paediatric nurses is a real issue, and therefore, how do we make sure that however many centres we have in the Northwest, it needs to be sustainable, and we need to be able to attract and retain sufficient numbers of nursing staff. And there are specialties like colorectal and like dermatology and several other specialties where it's really difficult to attract and retain doctors now. What I would say is actually little hospitals does really well. I can't think of the last time we went to try and recruit and couldn't actually appoint anybody. Whereas many hospitals across the country now are struggling to recruit, and we're not immune to that. In terms of nursing, we do well actually. Our nursing vacancy is about half the national average. National average is running between 10 and 11% vacancies. We're at 4.45. So in that sense, right now, we're in a reasonable position. However, moving forward, it's only going to get it ever more challenging. And a lot of what John's talking about is doing something versus the do-nothing option. And that actually, increasingly, we have to do something because the do-nothing option is going to be more difficult. We are looking at back in middle office, and we are looking at elective. Now what that really means is, keeping this really simple, we've got a major A&E department. It is often the busiest in the whole Northwest. We're now getting between 100 and